Welcome everyone to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee's 33rd meeting of 2020. Our first item today is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4, which is consideration of correspondence from the Scottish Government in private. Colleagues, are we agreed? We are. Thank you very much. We are agreed to take items 3 and 4 in private. Our second item today is an evidence session on the committee's regional marine planning inquiry with the Minister for Rural Affairs and the Natural Environment, Marie Dujon. Good morning, Minister, and welcome to your officials who are joining you. We have Damon Hewlett, the Marine Engagement and Information Manager, and David Pratt, Planning and Strategy for the Scottish Government. So, Minister, I'll start off. You'll know that we have been doing an inquiry of, we did a series of visits to all the current marine planning areas this time last year, and we've been taking evidence for some time now, and we've had an interim report which you'll have seen. But one of the things that that people have said to us that they are worried that we're potentially losing momentum on this in terms of the timing. So we have got the three areas that are currently underway, some further than others. Can I ask you what their general thoughts are on the timescales for getting more marine planning areas rolled out, and what ambitions and key outcomes there are for marine planning areas in general across Scotland?
Thank you for that, convener. I suppose I would just want to start by, well, first of all, thanking the committee for the work that you've done so far, because that really will help inform our approach going forward. So, as you mentioned, there are three regional marine planning partnerships. So, of course, Shetland was established in 2016, Clyde in 2017, and Orkney just towards the end of November. So, this is something that, of course, I think our overall objectives and what we would like to see haven't changed. I think one heartening thing that I saw from the evidence that the committee had taken so far was that there still seemed to be very much a value in regional marine planning. I think this has been a massive learning process for everyone involved, because obviously it is a completely new process and something that has been new to everyone. So I think that the timescales that had initially been planned for were obviously very ambitious, and we haven't been able to meet those. But I think it's only by going through that process that we've been able to see, well, exactly how long it may take, how some parts may have taken longer than initially expected. And that will, of course, help inform our approach from here on in. So I don't see it as us losing momentum, but that's where I think this is. Now that we've had a few marine planning partnerships established and we're still waiting for the plans to be implemented themselves, I think it's a good point for us to take stock of how that process has gone so far. And obviously each of the areas is very different as well, and I think there's a learning process from each part of that too. So again, that's where the work that you've done as a committee and all the evidence that you've received in the meantime will be really important for us to go through, to fully analyse and see where we really take the process from here in terms of establishing realistic timescales for looking at progressing further regional marine plans.
So I mean, I'm taking from that you are working on an assessment on how those partnerships have worked so far in Orkney, Shetland and in the Clyde, and that you will, off the back of that assessment, be making some decisions around potentially maybe future funding, the rollout of them to other areas and the timing on that. Can you give us a little bit more detail?
Oh, absolutely. Well, we'd be hoping to undertake an internal review of the processes so far. But I think what we also want to do is, that's where we look forward to the final report that the Environment Committee will produce, because I think that'll very much feed into the work and again, all feed into that process of us taking stock and really looking at where we go from here. And that will cover all aspects in terms of taking stock of the finances, what we need as opposed to what was projected at first too. So it's really important that we also look and discuss with each of the partnerships. That's where their feedback has been really important as part of this process as well, because I think all of the learning, there's lots of valuable lessons in that that will help us in other areas. I mean, as I highlighted in my first answer there, each of the areas has been very different. You obviously have Clyde, which is big. It's a large delegate and it is very diverse within that. And then you also have the island authorities. So I think that's been one of the challenges of this process so far, is that you can't have a one-size-fits-all approach to it. You very much have to take it region by region to see what will work where, and that will be different for everyone. But there have been very valuable lessons that have come out of this process so far, so we want to make sure that we learn from that as we progress the rollout of this into the future.
I'll be handing over to my colleague Mark Ruskell in a moment, who wants to talk about, you know, some of the national objectives and how this fits in. But can I ask you a specific question about the role of marine planning in the Blue Economy Action Plan? Just where does it fit in? How important is it?
Absolutely vital, because I mean, the Blue Economy, the overarching themes and ambition of that are for clean, healthy, safe, productive and diverse seas that are managed to meet the long-term needs of nature as well as the people that use them. So the vision that's set out in our National Marine Plan is very closely aligned to delivering the overall aims of the Blue Economy approach. So the National Marine Plan and the regional marine plans that will be developed are going to be absolutely key in relation to the to being long-term delivery mechanisms for the Blue Economy approach. And we're also due to undertake a review of the National Marine Plan in the first part of 2021. So we'll be, as we go through that process, we'll be looking at that and considering whether changes might be necessary to the plan to help deliver the Blue Economy approach. But essentially, and of course, there are so many other challenges to take into consideration as part of that process as well, given where we are with climate change and the climate emergency. We've had COVID-19, there's been Brexit. So I think this will be a really important review of the National Marine Plan that we'll be taking forward early next year. But of course, with the Blue Economy Action Plan, that will be completely interlinked and absolutely vital to the work we take forward.
Okay, I'm going to hand over to Mark Ruskell, who has some specific questions around that. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think that was a useful last response as well about how the National Marine, you know, will knit together with the regional marine plans potentially. But I just wanted to ask you a bit more about, you know, where the regional marine planning partnerships really take their lead from. So we have some evidence that was brought to the committee about one of the French marine planning partnerships, where they have 26 objectives that are all set nationally, and that planning partnership is working towards delivering those. That's slightly different to what we have at the moment in Scotland, with the kind of the regional marine partnerships having their own sort of autonomy, very much selecting their own objectives. What's your vision going forward? I mean, do you see these bodies as being the primary way to deliver the objectives that will be in the National Marine Plan, and how much kind of direction from government would you expect to see?
Oh, I think that's where, I mean, obviously I see a key role for regional marine plans as part of that, and see them as being vital in terms of the work that we do going forward. So obviously we have the National Marine Plan, which sets the overall framework for that, and I would very much envisage the regional marine plans supporting that and taking their direction from that as well. So again, that's where I think probably all of this is happening at the right time, if we're taking stock of how the regional marine plans have been operating so far. We're due to be looking at the National Marine Plan and assessing that and looking at whether that needs to be amended or changed potentially early next year. I think that will put us in good stead for progressing all of that work. But I do see that regional marine plans will be absolutely vital to that, because I think an important part of all of this is it's important that we have the right policy and that framework set out at a national level, but we also need to have the local ownership, and they're key to the decision making in terms of that as well. And that's where I see the regional marine planning partnerships, and from that the regional marine plans as being absolutely vital in helping to deliver our national ambitions, but at a local level and with the buy-in of local stakeholders too.
And do you see any sort of boundaries to the work of the marine planning partnership? So, for example, you know, like fisheries management is something that marine planning partnerships around the world, you know, sometimes direct fisheries, working with fishers themselves, sometimes they stay away from that. Conservation, designation of marine protected areas, priority marine features, management for those features. Is that something where you would expect our regional marine planning ships to be taking a lead role following government objectives on this? Or do you think there are some things which are kind of left to Marine Scotland or another body to be managing, like a regional inshore fisheries group or whatever?
Well, I also think that a lot of these, it's important that all of these different interests are represented within a marine planning partnership. And I think that's very much the objective of it. And I think that there's the flexibility there that allows the marine planning partnerships to be able to build that and to have that. I mean, you can see, obviously, the Clyde Marine Planning Partnership has 24 different delegates there. The island authorities have a different setup where they have advisory groups that encompass a number of different interests. I mean, you talked there about the fisheries interests. I mean, obviously, we have the regional inshore fisheries groups, and we see that as being the main route for engagement between commercial fishermen and marine planning partnerships to ensure that fisheries interests are represented within that. And of course, ministers, we have the responsibility to approve regional plans. So we would, of course, be checking that throughout that interests are widely represented. And obviously, I mean, regional marine plans are binding on decision makers, including Marine Scotland, fisheries managers. So I think that they would also have to be satisfied in turn that any decisions that are taken are done in line with the regional marine plans. So I hope that answers your question, but I don't know if you need any further information on that.
Yeah, I'm just sort of interested. I mean, could if we had a rollout of marine planning partnerships across every single part of our coastline seas in Scotland, do you think that could speed up or slow down our work to designate marine protected areas or priority marine features and get agreed management plans for those? Because at the moment it has been slow, the rollout. So would this speed things up, or would it actually make it slower?
I'm really not too sure about that. I mean, obviously there are different statutory roles involved in that, and it's up to ministers to designate marine protected areas. As you'll be aware, we still have some areas that are awaiting designation, but we hope to be in a position to do that very soon. So, and I think that we see, in terms of the areas that we've been looking at in relation to marine protected areas, I think that we have, our network will be nearing completion. So in terms of the further rollout of work, it may not impact that, but obviously, there is then what potential measures you could put in place in relation to whether you'd be looking to implement fisheries management measures or not. I'm not too sure whether that, sorry, my answer probably isn't too helpful even in terms of whether that would, I would envisage that speeding up or necessarily slowing down that process. But I think that marine planning partnerships and the regional marine plans obviously have a key role in looking at that, because they have to develop policies that contribute to the conservation objectives of designated sites. So they do have a key role, but in terms of speeding up the designations, as I say, we're expecting to be in a position to announce delegations very soon. So I don't see it particularly having an impact on that process itself.
Thank you, Mark. But other members want to come in on some of the areas that you've opened up there. So I'm going to come to Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Convener. We understand that Scotland is unique in creating new marine areas or marine regions, but there's a whole set of complex steps and processes required to establish a marine planning partnership before the process of planning can actually begin. And it's, as we know, it's led to delays. That contrasts with England, which has established uniformity in terms of process. So I would like your views on the Scottish Government's oversight of the process of establishing marine planning partnerships, particularly in light of the committee's inquiry, which found there was over complex government structures and ineffective leadership. There was a clear lack of guidance and input from central government. Can I ask you what you for changes and how the Scottish Government will oversee the establishment of these partnerships in the future?
Well, I can completely understand some of the concerns that have been raised. And again, I would say that, and just reiterate what I alluded to earlier, and the fact that this has been a massive learning process for us. It's the first time that we've been through this process and establishing regional marine partnerships. So again, that's where all the work that's happening right now in terms of examining that process and interrogating it has been really important to see, well, what lessons can we learn from that for the future rollout? And again, if we go back to what I'd said previously, I mean, this isn't something where it's not necessarily easy to roll out regional marine plans and establish marine planning partnerships, because it's not a uniform approach that we can take. So we have to do what is most suitable in each area. And of course, from what we've seen from the marine planning partnerships established so far, that has been very different and has operated quite differently. So we need to learn from that. And that's where I think the feedback and some of the evidence that I've seen from the Clyde Marine Planning Partnership and looking at the lessons learned, that will help in the establishment of the of future creation of marine planning partnerships, because yeah, there will be a lot of learning to take away from that that we'll then be able to use when we're working with others who are looking to establish themselves and create regional marine plans. And of course, the internal review that we would be undertaking as well will feed into that process too. So I don't know whether David or Damon might have anything further that they want to add on that.
I might come in here if that's okay. Oh,
yes, can you hear me? Yes, yeah. I can hear you perfectly.
Yeah. I think especially if we look at the comparison with Scotland v England, it's two very different systems. England, obviously, there's a UK marine policy statement which governs the whole of the UK seas. And then England has split its marine area into regions, but they don't have a national marine plan for England. And from speaking with a number of stakeholders, there is a feeling that they lack that alignment between plans for all of the regions. And for instance, a developer or a kind of user of the marine space could very find there's different rules in different regions. We obviously have a national marine plan, which provides a kind of solid central focus for all of Scotland's seas. And then we're actually trying to layer in more of that definition and the ability to be more flexible on a regional basis in addition to that, and produce regional plans that are more reflective of the kind of communities that will be affected by them. And I also think we shouldn't lose sight here of the fact that we are only kind of a number of years into setting up a kind of marine equivalent of a terrestrial system that's been in place for decades, if not far longer than that. And to try and get a national plan as well as some of these regions up and running, not to mention actually delivering their plans or hopefully in the coming months, some solid progress has been made in a relatively short period of time if you think about the kind of framework as a whole.
Finlay?
Yep, thank you. You know, so there's mixed message there. On one hand, you're talking about the advantages of having a national marine plan, but that being flexible enough. But we've heard that currently there is a lack of flexibility in the legislation, which allows for community representation and membership of the marine planning partnerships. Indeed, the provisions of the Marine Scotland Act 2010 on the composition of these partnerships was considered by some stakeholders as far too prescriptive and not allowing flexibility. Indeed, Orkney Island Council required an amendment of the Act to be allowed to be a sole delegate. So are you considering a review of the legislation to allow greater flexibility to find appropriate local solutions for marine planning?
I think certainly at the moment, I don't necessarily think that a change in legislation would be needed for that. However, based on the evidence that the committee's received, and if you have different recommendations to that, then obviously we'll consider your final report in detail when it comes to those recommendations. Because, as you alluded to in your question there, I mean, the thinking behind the legislation at the moment, I think, I mean, it already has that flexibility there, I think, which allows different approaches to be taken. So it obviously outlines what the delegate or the marine planning partnership could comprise, but it's not prescriptive in that sense. Obviously, they have to represent specific interests, but I do think the flexibility in the approach and the flexibility within the legislation is shown through the marine planning partnerships that we have in place so far. So, for example, Shetland has two members as part of the official delegate with a much larger advisory group, whereas, as I've mentioned in a previous response, Clyde has 24 members as part of the delegate itself. And again, Orkney Islands Council is a sole delegate, and like Shetland, they have a wider advisory group to help them in that work. So I think we could, as a minister, I could ask that the delegate includes a community representative. However, I do think that there are options there, and the flexibility is there to allow marine planning partnerships to look at that themselves. But again, if the committee do have recommendations in that regard when they're considering their final report, then of course we will take that into consideration.
Okay, thanks. I'd like to move on to training and guidance now. Again, in evidence we heard that from stakeholders, there was a lack of clear guidance and input from central government, and there needed to be clearer guidance on the roles and responsibilities of marine planning partnerships. And the process of actually developing the regional plan, there was a call for new national guidance and training to allow a better understanding among the stakeholders of the process, which would encourage trust and collaborative working. And we know that, unfortunately, is not happening in any of the plans at the moment. So what are your ambitions to provide clearer guidance and support for the groups, particularly where we see there can be tension between stakeholders, and guidance might help that?
Well, that's where, again, it has been really important to see the lessons learned from Clyde and from Shetland in relation to that, and that will give us some valuable information going forward to see, well, yeah, what can we learn from that process, what could we have done better, and how could we improve that for the future. So again, all that work and the committee's report will really help us look at that and identify where there are problems, because obviously all delegates have to have their governance arrangements clearly stated, and the importance of those arrangements is, I think, particularly highlighted with the Clyde Marine Planning Partnership, I think, given the size of the area covered, as well as the size of the delegate and the different issues that can bring with it, as opposed to in Shetland or, say, in Orkney. So, yes, I do think that we do have to strike a balance between being overly prescriptive and allowing for structures and approaches which reflect local circumstances, and having that flexibility that I referred to in my previous answer. But yeah, that's where we have to also make sure that we learn our lessons from what has happened in the rollout up until now, make sure we learn from that and adapt that moving forward.
And finally, one of the things that our reports have picked up is that the underpinning legislation in Scotland doesn't provide for management of fisheries via marine planning. But we know that marine planning can support fisheries. Can you tell us, given the current limited budget and powers of regional inshore fisheries group, and also the fact that these fisheries groups are sometimes classed as hard to reach because they're working hours and the very nature of small businesses, how are you going to strengthen the regional inshore fisheries groups and make sure they have the opportunity to collaborate and effectively with the planning partnerships and the wider marine stakeholders. I want to particularly look at the resources, because I understand that generally developing marine plans can cost between 100,000 and in some cases nearly 30 million per plan. And Scotland's investment in these plans is relatively, or I would say comparatively low, at only between 250,000 and 300,000. Have you any plans to help support regional inshore fishery groups from that budget, or increase the budget to ensure they've got an effective voice on these planning groups?
I think there's probably a couple of points in that question. So if I do miss one, then please just remind me towards the end, because I think for the first part, in relation to regional inshore fisheries groups and their role, I'd probably reflect back to partner response to Mark Ruskell, because I know that there was concerns raised in the evidence that was given to the committee about the interaction between the regional inshore fisheries groups and regional marine planning partnerships. But again, we see the regional inshore fisheries groups as being the main route for engagement between commercial fisheries and marine planning partnerships, and really to ensure that that fisheries interests are represented within that. And again, as a minister, we have the responsibility to approve regional marine plans. So we have to check that interaction there has worked as we would have intended it to. And I mean, the regional inshore fisheries groups make recommendations to Marine Scotland on fisheries management measures, which means that, of course, Marine Scotland then have the ability to check compliance with regional marine plans too. And as part of the broader work that we're doing, we also have the Future of Fisheries Management Strategy, and that will be due to publish. That will be published shortly, and of course that will again feed into this work too. But again, we see the regional inshore fisheries being the main route for that engagement, and their fisheries management plans will inform the regional marine plan development, and in turn the regional and national plans will of course take into account any future decisions over fisheries management measures. In relation to the, I think you had a point about the financing of that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the big issues we have with smaller fishing businesses and in turn the inshore fisheries group is a lack of finance and a lack of resource for them to make their position clear, particularly in light of some of the huge financial clout, if you like, of the NGOs and environmental lobbyists, whatever. So it's there on a different scale completely to the inshore fisheries groups. So yeah, what were your plans to fund these groups to ensure that they do effectively represent their members and interests of the fisheries?
Well, first of all, I say there's obviously continual learning that we're doing in engaging with fisheries, and we do regularly engage with fisheries as well. I mean, in relation to the financing of it, I mean, of course, that's part of the work that we want to go away and look at in terms of our internal review, because I know that that's a point that's been raised throughout evidence as well. Obviously, we work in very financially constrained times. I probably don't need to tell anybody on the committee that. And I think what we've been able to deliver so far is just on the budgets that we've had is a testament to the work of everybody that's been involved in that process. So I would just say, I mean, again, that's going to be an important part of the work that we do going forward from here in terms of having the committee's final report, the internal review that we do, alongside that, and as well as any future work to consider where we best need to target the resource and looking at what resource exactly is needed to help us in this process.
Thank you. And I'll move on to questions from Stuart Stevenson.
Good morning, Minister. I wonder if I can start with the balance between marine activities and development, because particularly in the area I represent, the northeast of Scotland, there is clearly mixed use the marine environment, for wind farms, potentially for tidal energy, and of course very significant fisheries interests both inshore and indeed further off, and of course significant environmental issues with marine life in particular areas like the Murray Firth. So are you looking at spatial planning in the regional marine plans? And if so, how do we navigate our way to getting the balance between the many interests that there are competing for space in the marine environment?
I think in relation to that spatial approach, that's certainly something that can be, that's an approach that can be taken by marine planning partnerships, because in the National Marine Plan, we've said that, I mean, it states there that regional marine plans should consider identifying suitable areas for various things, whether that be for submarine cables, and they can also, or they should consider identifying regionally important ports and harbours. So I think that there's the ability there for marine planning partnerships and the regional marine plans to certainly take that into consideration if they feel that's appropriate. So the flexibility is there that allows them to do that, because I think it's really important that, as you outlined in your question, obviously there's lots of competing resources in our waters at the moment. But I do think that the flexibility is there that should allow that approach to be taken, should marine planning partnerships decide to pursue that. So, but I think I'll bring David in on this one.
Maybe shouldn't lose sight of the kind of sectoral planning work that we also do. And obviously, the Minister and the Energy Minister jointly with ourselves took forward the sectoral plan for offshore wind energy, which was a huge spatial planning exercise. And while the outputs are obviously spatial designation for large offshore wind farms, there's a huge body of work in taking in many of the marine stakeholders that you have just mentioned. So we need to get to grips with all the data in relation to what's happening in the marine environment, the relevant marine users. We need to compile some quite comprehensive assessments before we can get to that point of producing an actual final plan in terms of a spatial plan. And even then, that's been through quite significant consultation processes. And this is quite a big burden, but the more kind of sectors we can drive some of these initiatives with, and we can do these exercises in conjunction and when have regional planning authorities actually helping us and informing us, and especially as we've seen with working with the coastal partnerships, we can get to more local stakeholders by engaging in these organisations for such exercises. So it's been has a lot of merit in trying to produce these sectoral plans with that spatial definition involving the regions and ultimately enabling regions to integrate some of those outputs and where they feel necessary, help us to actually shape more appropriate kind of spatial definitions for the activities that take place within those regions. It's not to say that they won't be able to do this as individual authorities further down the line. We certainly see that as something in an area that they can get into. We just shouldn't lose sight of the fact that to do spatially defined planning at the moment is a very, very big task that requires, for example, a sectoral marine plan had probably upwards of 5,000 pages worth of consultation through the various stages of documentation. And this is a big undertaking for a regional partnership who are still trying to develop the actual regional plans and policies and get their kind of initial framework in place.
I wonder if I can just come back and probe a little bit about the role of central government, because I think, Minister, your response was very much about local decision making, and that's of course very welcome, because in the local area there's the best possible understanding of the tensions that there might be between what may be competing interests. But equally, things like wind farms and or engineering uses of the marine environment, which involve very substantial investments. We kind of need to start from a position of some certainty that it's worth pursuing, because even to work up a proposal can cost substantial amounts of money. So how are ministers and central government going to play their role in all this, in the decision making? Because it won't simply be a matter for the local decision making, because it interacts with national policies, not just in your portfolio, but in other portfolios.
Well, I think that's where the work that David highlighted there has been a really key example of how we've been able to make that work, because obviously we have the National Marine Plan, we'll have the Blue Economy Action Plan as well. So we have the overarching framework and policy direction there. But that body of work that David just talked about there in terms of the offshore wind sectoral marine plan, it really was a large positive body of work that really cut across all those sectors. And that's where we see the Blue Economy Action Plan being important as well and vital. And because, as you say, this isn't just something that just falls within my immediate portfolio. It's something that cuts right across all areas of government. So that's where that kind of work has been really important. And I think we've shown through the sectoral offshore wind plan just how we've been able to make that work and bring all these different interests together. We'll work across all the different interests in the way that we did in producing the plan.
To how we might integrate the terrestrial planning with marine planning. I just give a small example, and it is a very small example, but it may illustrate a more general point, that there was an issue for where an electricity cable was going to be routed from some of the Murray Firth developments to a substation. Some distance inland, and the issue arose that you had a view of where the cable could be laid in the marine environment, but the initial proposals for where it hit the land crossed a beach which those who were interested in the terrestrial planning would consider very inappropriate, and it took quite a lot of work to integrate the on-land decision making with the offshore decision making to get the cable hitting the beach at a more appropriate point. So it illustrated some of the difficulties in integrating the marine and terrestrial planning. So how can government and indeed the partnerships work together to make sure that it's more seamless, not just from the point of view of the developers, important as that is, but also, of course, for local interests, local communities?
I think that is a key, and that's going to be a really important point as we move forward, because I think, obviously, we would want with the terrestrial and marine planning systems to be integrated and work well alongside and with each other and not against each other. And I think that is going to be really important if we want to see the regional marine planning process work. But also that is going to be an ongoing and evolving process, because we don't as yet have any regional marine plans in place. So it is something that we will have to monitor. But I mean, as it stands at the moment, regional marine plans have to be compatible with the development plan for any areas that they adjoin. And strategic and local development plans are also required to have any regard to any adopted national or regional marine plan adjoining that strategic area or the local area itself too. So, I mean, as part of that, Marine Scotland are a statutory consultee in these processes, and they engage in the local development plan processes. So they're able to, within that role, they'll be able to ensure that marine plans are recognised in any local development plans that are being reviewed. But again, as I've said, we don't have regional marine plans in place yet, but I think that we have the structures there to ensure that the processes are as integrated as they can be, and that the all relevant plans are taken into consideration. So this is something, though, we will have to closely monitor, though, as we go forward and as the regional marine plans are put in place.
Thank you. And Mark, you wanted to pick up on something that was discussed in this theme. Mark?
Yeah, it was the discussion around offshore wind. I'm aware that, you know, there was obviously the judicial review a couple of years back, and I think one of the issues that emerged from that is the availability of ecological data that was being generated by the industry, but how that then fed into the consenting process and whether that was available to wider stakeholders. I mean, is that something that for example, you would see an East Coast Regional Marine Partnership coordinating some of that work, or is that best done with Marine Scotland or with a sort of sector offshore wind working group? I mean, could a Regional Marine Partnership be the sort of conduit for all the data and the information that's needed to make sensible decisions about where developments take place and how to mitigate them?
I mean, that's where I think it probably comes back to some of the points that David talked about earlier, because I think that maybe some of that work could be quite onerous for regional marine partnerships to take on, and especially when we're talking about the scale of what we were discussing in relation to the sectoral marine plan for offshore energy. So obviously we don't want to put too heavy a burden in relation to marine planning partnerships and the work that they can be expected or would look to deliver. But I'll bring David in on that point.
And for example, the what you're talking about in terms of East Coast monitoring, it's obviously essential that we understand the true impacts for ornithology throughout all the Scottish waters. But this is actually quite a significant burden. And as we're seeing from some of the early offshore wind farms who've maybe had some individual turbine monitoring, it generates such a quantity of high definition, kind of comprehensive data that the actual processing of that is a very big task in itself and quite a big and expensive ask. So I think when we're coordinating these regional groups and we're looking at regional representatives and experts to engage in all the kind of post-consent issues, not just ornithology, but how do we, if there's community issues in certain parts of the country or there's shipping interests and we can get kind of ports and shipping stakeholders, how do we get those regional stakeholders into those kind of post-planning groups to understand some of these issues? There's a definite role there, but we just need to be careful not to provide a regional partnership with something which would be kind of unduly burdensome and also very, very resource intensive to actually process and get an output to any such data.
Thank you. I'm going to come to Claudia Beamish. You have some questions around financing. Claudia.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Minister and your officials. I'm going to explore financing and then my colleague Angus MacDonald is going to look at resourcing and expertise. And just for context, as you'll know, Minister, but for the record, the committee's inquiry found the following key issues: a lack of human support to deliver regional marine planning, particularly in the following areas: staff, marine planning expertise and resources for marine planning partnerships, and funding and expertise for research and data collection and monitoring, and insufficient funding for the wider rollout of the marine planning. And I think it would be fair to say that it was one of the most common concerns, if not the most common concern, was the finance or lack of it. Our research, which we commissioned on international comparisons, found that funding for marine planning in Scotland, as I understand it, between 250 and 300,000 per plan spread over 3 years, which you may want to explore with us, was, I quote, in the research, it was highlighted it was significantly below the estimated level of funding in the international examples. I'm not going to go into those because they are in the paper in terms of time. But I would also highlight that the research showed that there was a significant return for the funding that was put in. So could we just start by exploring with you, Minister, the current resources within Marine Scotland to support regional marine planning and just have your thoughts and those of your officials as appropriate on that, please.
Okay, thank you for that. And I think that's definitely what I picked up from obviously going through your evidence, reading the interim report as well, and the concerns around funding and how that could have impeded progress of rolling out regional marine planning. Just to give you an idea of, or I'm sure, I don't know if you have the figures in front of you there, in terms of the finance and resources that we've put into this so far, we have a dedicated resource of £150,000 in place for 2020 to 2021, and that includes a new regional planning officer to improve communications with and in between the partnerships. Crown Estate Scotland is also expected to contribute the same amount, so £150,000 for 3 years as of the 1st of April 2021. And again, beyond that, I mean, I know I've said that in previous responses to questions that have come up today, we will be looking at our overall approach to the funding for regional marine planning following our own internal assessment and, of course, any outcomes or recommendations that the committee makes also makes in that regard. I mean, I've already highlighted today just the financial constraints that all areas of government are under at the moment, but this is an area that we will be continuing to look at further as we go forward, because I do, obviously it's important that we take this feedback from people that have been through that process as well, and look to address that however we can. And again, that's where this taking stock is absolutely vital. But I don't know if David or Damon have anything further that they want to add on that here.
Yeah, I'll maybe touch on the point on the kind of expertise and what we've got internally, and I would say there's probably similarities with what I was saying earlier on about the development of the planning system as a whole. And
sorry, I don't want to be rude, but could I just stop you, David? Because actually, yeah. Angus wants to on expertise, and I feel that maybe he would want to set the context for that. Sorry if I wasn't clear about that.
Yeah.
It's okay. More about the general finance, if you had comments on that. Sorry.
That's fine. I'll possibly, Damon may wish to add a few points here on the kind of the way we have been working the system over our recent years. And as the Minister alluded to, it's probably less money than was originally envisaged, but there is still a significant amount of money that's still afforded from Marine Scotland and the Scottish Government into the partnerships, as well as actually the expertise in other parts of the public sector and other parts of Marine Scotland to continue to engage with the regional planning partnerships as they develop their plans. I don't know if you want to add anything here, Damon.
Yeah, I think that's right, David. As the Minister alluded to earlier, we intend to review our approach to financing, so to have a look at the internal resources and financing that we allocate towards regional marine planning within Marine Scotland, and the financing that we allocate to partnerships. At the moment, we allocate just under £400,000 a year to marine plan partnerships and to local coastal partnerships to work towards regional marine plans. And as the Minister pointed out, we have a dedicated internal staff resource of £150,000. If you look at the finances, I mean, we haven't seen the report on international examples, so we look forward to seeing that, and we'll consider it really carefully alongside our review as well, and alongside the final report of the committee. I think this will be really interesting stuff. By our estimations, Shetland has spent in the region of £500,000 in getting to the stage it's at now, which is very close to being able to submit its draft plan to Scottish ministers. That's a lot less than we forecasted way back when we did estimates, when we published and brought forward the Marine Scotland Act in 2010. So I think we need to look at that carefully. These are obviously different financial circumstances to what we were in back then. However, I think we need to look at it and say, you know, if we are able to deliver it as we seem to have been for less than we thought, there's a good thing about that. You know, it's good use of public resources. But we'll certainly take on board, it's clear from the interim report, we'll certainly take on board concerns and look really carefully at where we can make improvements and where we can best target any additional resource. As the Minister pointed out, we managed to secure additional funding from Crown Estate Scotland. So where can we best target that going forward and get the best value for money?
Hopeful. From everyone in terms of our scrutiny. You've highlighted, Damon, and the Minister has the Crown Estate possibilities. Could you perhaps explain a little bit more about how that might work or how things are going to be developed in terms of any finance that might come from that possibility? And also, is there any consideration of marine industry levies or any other forms of funding, thinking laterally, as we all have to, that might come to marine planning partnerships? Thank you.
No, I think you're absolutely right there. I think we'll have to think and look at about any further resource. I think in terms of the detail of the Crown Estate monies, I'll probably bring David in on that, or I don't know if David or Damon want to cover that point in particular. But I mean, I know this is something that areas have looked at themselves. There's obviously the funding input from local authorities that are involved in the marine planning partnerships too. But I know that those areas have been able to access other funds, whether that's through EMFF. I think that Clyde have, I think in the region of over £200,000 that they've been able to bring in to help with some of the work that they've been doing on public engagement. Orkney have had around £120,000 again from EMFF to help with some of the work that they've been doing. So there are other avenues, but obviously I know that for the bodies themselves, they can be restricted in sometimes in terms of the types of funds that they can go for. But you're absolutely right. I think that's the way that we're thinking now. We have to look at where these opportunities are. And again, we'll be having that internal review to look at how, just exactly as Damon outlined, how we can best target the resources that we have, as well as looking forward to hearing about those international examples and how that works elsewhere. But yeah, so if either David or Damon want to come in about the Crown Estate Scotland funding itself.
Yeah, I'll cover that one off. We've obviously, there's kind of two aspects to this. One is obviously there's the Scottish Consolidated Fund, which provides a distribution of the revenues from 0 to 12 nautical miles to local coastal authorities. And we understand, for example, certain islands authorities are looking to make maybe some of their contributions from what they receive from that fund, because it is a partnership in terms of what we can bring to the table, what the authorities can bring to the table, and other partners who could get involved. And then, in addition to that, we're also working with Crown Estate Scotland in terms of some of their central funding work, and they have committed an additional £150,000 for the next 3 years, starting next year. And we would look to see how we can then use that, for instance, to make additional contributions that could, for example, introduce another partnership or something along those lines. So it's kind of two strands to how the Crown Estate money will work.
Finally, you referred to the European Fund, Minister, and that's been fundamentally important for coastal communities. And I hadn't been aware that it's fed into the regional marine plans. But if you could either today or through your officials or write to us about what hopes there are for for next year, once we're no longer part of the EU, what the opportunities are and whether the UK government is, what I'm sure have been requests to ensure that funding continues in some form.
Oh, absolutely, because I think the likes of EMFF have been absolutely vital for coastal communities, but I'd be quite happy to write to the committee and give an up-to-date position on where we are with that and with discussions with the UK government.
Thank you, Claudia. Just ahead of coming to Angus MacDonald, Finlay, you wanted in briefly on a financial question.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Given that the setup of the planning system in England was estimated to be about 34 million, that was the cost, and the running cost about £1 million per year, but that estimated to bring in a benefit of 46 million. Now, we're looking at £250,000 to £300,000 per plan over a 3-year period as the finance that the Scottish Government are putting in, and it's significantly low. So I'm a bit concerned there appears to be, there's no recognition that this is a real issue, because the most commonly cited concern throughout the whole of the committee's evidence, the whole inquiry, was that there was a lack of central government finance. And that was, you know, that was preventing long-term investment in regional planning.
Finlay, can you round up your question, please? We've got other members wanting to come in. You've already asked this question. Could you put a question to the minister, please?
I think I did at the end there, but maybe didn't hear. Is the minister satisfied the level of funding is adequate given examples from everywhere else, and that it was the most commonly cited issue?
In terms of, I mean, well, we're not exactly comparing like with like in terms of other examples. And again, if there are international examples there, I've already said that we obviously want to interrogate that and look at that in more detail. But again, I would just come back to, that's where all of this work is really important. All the lessons that will have come through in the evidence in the committee, what will be in the committee's final report, that's where we want to take stock of this. We have an internal assessment to really look at this and look at how we can best target resources. Because of course, I mean, I think that came across clearly in evidence that people see the need, the value of regional marine plans and regional marine planning partnerships. So we want to ensure that that is a success as far as possible. So we will be considering all of that information.
Okay, can I come to Angus MacDonald, please?
Okay, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your officials. And also thanks to Claudia Beamish for allowing me to cover the issue of expertise. One issue that we certainly found while taking evidence around the country was insufficient marine planning expertise in some regions to support regional marine planning. I certainly heard the issue raised by stakeholders in various areas of the Clyde, and Aberdeen Council stated in evidence that, and I quote, marine environmental knowledge and experience is largely outside of the skills and training of existing staff, end quote. So evidence has suggested that increased funding and longer term contracts with competitive salaries are required to attract the required expertise or to upskill existing staff. So what's the Scottish Government doing or planning to do to raise the profile of marine planning as a profession and increasing the availability of marine planning expertise? And is it something that will be considered in your internal review?
Thank you for that question, because I think that is a point that I definitely picked up from going through the evidence. And I think it was concerning to see that from again, you mentioned Aberdeen City Council raising that in their evidence, and that they felt that there wasn't the relevant expertise there. So again, that is a point that we have to take away and consider to see how we can go about tackling that. But one thing I would like to think that as we go through this process and rolling out regional marine plans and developing these in each of the regions, is that it does raise the profile of marine planning, and I would hope that generates more interest in that as a profession. We play a constructive role in things like the MAST Marine Planning Group, and I think alongside that work, I'm just more than happy to look at what more we can do here, and see how we can best address those concerns. Because obviously, if we want to see the success of regional marine planning, we hope we would need to see that we have the expertise in there as well to help drive that forward and for us to support that as much as we can. So I don't know if David or Damon have anything further that they would want to add there.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. What I was about to say earlier on, when the terrestrial planning system started, there probably weren't many planners. And this is about trying to build up that body of expertise and experts and actually try and build it as a profession. I would say that having worked in this for probably 10 to 12 years, I'm as close to a marine planner as you could probably get, and I still don't really consider myself a professional marine planner, because there's no such thing as yet. And it is professionally recognised, it's institutionalised, and that takes a lot of time. And obviously, we have town planners that come into marine planning with RTPI. I'm from the Environmental Management and Assessment Institute, and it's trying to build that all together over a kind of prolonged period of time where we do have enough experts. And this would have started with very few, and it's continually expanding year on year. We're seeing Heriot Watt, the University of the Highlands and Islands, with marine planning master's courses. We're starting to see roles for graduates within some of the partnerships. And then this will be something which will evolve. And don't forget, a lot of graduates and come through for Marine Scotland licensing operations team and maybe get experience in a different part of the marine planning system. And while it's not working on plan specifically, it is within that broader marine management and marine planning kind of framework, and we would see this as something we would definitely like to concentrate on and see grow in the coming years.
Okay, thank you. It will certainly be interesting to see how that develops. Clearly, from our experience in Shetland, the situation there is exemplary, in my view, but there were challenges that we identified in local authorities around the Clyde. So I'm pleased to note that it's on your radar, and we can look forward to future developments there. If I could turn to a data collection, evidence that we received in the committee identified the importance of data collection and scientific monitoring to support regional marine planning. And on our travels, the committee identified good examples again of collaborative working in Shetland and also in the Clyde, but there's always clearly room for improvement. So what opportunities are there to improve collaboration between marine planning partnerships, academic expertise and fishers in data collection and monitoring for RMPs?
You're absolutely right. I think there definitely are opportunities there for improving that collaboration. And as I just said in my previous answer as well, I mean, we play a constructive role in the Mass Marine Planning Group, so I think there's a role through that. And there definitely are opportunities to improve that and to make sure it works better. But I would also, I mean, we're also looking to establish a National Marine Planning Forum. And I think the idea with that would be that at least that will be a forum to help share learning and experience and hopefully provide those opportunities for trying to improve that collaboration there too. So that's where I would obviously look forward to the committee's findings on it. But yeah, there are pieces of work that we're looking at to try and encourage that too. So I don't know if David or Damon want to come in on that point.
Yeah, I'll just add that we're continually trying to evolve the National Marine Planning Interactive Tool, which is obviously a GIS tool with around 800 to 1,000 data layers. These are publicly accessible, and we expect partnerships to try and use some of that. We're trying to develop a new assessment of Scotland's seas. And it's important to note from the outset, we were looking to try and get as much of that data cut to the regions themselves, which would enable them the ability to do more regional analysis. We have Marine Scotland Information, which provides a raft of evidence that we're involved with and have collected through Marine Scotland Science. And that's all publicly available and stuff that we encourage stakeholders to get involved with. And for example, on engaging the fishing sector, I think I would go back to the Offshore Wind Plan, where we did a really intensive engagement with the sector around where the activity, the intensity takes place. We really tried to go over and above by sending officials out with certain community events to specifically meet fishermen in ports to understand some of the tracks and some of the kind of routes that we're all taking, so we could factor that into the planning process. And it's through learning, through initiatives like that, that we can get a lot of that data and make sure that it's integrated into the planning processes, both at a national and regional level.
Okay, that's good to hear, convener. Engagement is what it's all about, so look forward to further progress with that. Thank you.
Thank you. And a very interesting line of questioning. I mean, given that I think one of the successes of the Shetland experience was the collaboration with the North Atlantic Fisheries College, and it seems to me that, you know, we're looking at a green recovery and we're looking at areas in which future jobs and areas of expertise as we're sort of, you know, pushing our agenda towards net zero. This seems to be an area of expertise and job creation that we really need to maybe put some real heft behind. I don't know if the Minister's got any reflections on that.
Absolutely, and that's what I would say, that there are some really exciting opportunities there for that expertise to build. And I think the profile of these roles will obviously be a lot higher as well. So absolutely, I think you've hit the nail on the head there when we're looking at a green recovery. So I think there are potentially a lot of opportunities there that we can really capitalise on.
Okay. Mark, you wanted to come in off the back of, I'm not sure if it was Claudia's questions or Angus's questions, but you've put a request.
Well, it was actually kind of off the back of what you just said, actually, convener, but got one line this morning, but it was about the industrial strategy, really, for those kind of sectors, particularly offshore wind. So I know that with the ScotWind round, that developers are already putting in supply chain statements. And there will be sort of, you know, planning issues associated with that, the kind of infrastructure we need in ports and harbours to supply, you know, build, design, operate, maintain wind farms of the future. I mean, is that something that, again, you see as more kind of the sector dealing with that, with marine planning partnerships kind of offering a view, or should we actually be integrating all of that into a marine plan which really, you know, sets out what the economic opportunities are and actually plans around that? So we're actually planning ports and harbours directly now to meet those opportunities for jobs.
So do you mean in relation to any extra infrastructure, what we'd be looking to build around that need for extra training opportunities and the role of marine planning partnerships within that?
Yeah. Yeah, really, sort of who takes that lead in terms of strategy for offshore wind? Is that a sector plan, or is it something that actually is integrated into a marine plan? Just trying to work out where it sits, who takes the lead on that?
Yeah, well, obviously, I mean, we have the national marine plan there as a policy, because obviously we don't have regional marine plans in place everywhere or marine planning partnerships. So I think that's something that we would have to look at on that bigger scale initially. But I think that with marine planning partnerships and regional marine plans, obviously there is a role there too. Sorry, David, I don't know if you want to come in on that.
It's worth noting that there's a multitude of bodies that have to all be aligned here. So the sectoral plan is essentially the first building block in identifying resource areas that we consider on the whole have come through a sustainability assessment and could be taken forward. It's then getting the other kind of public sector tools into kind of a mode where they can enable. So if there is going to be a port facility that's required, we know the regional planning partnership is involved in discussions. We know as they're evolving their plan, these are being considered. We know as a national marine plan evolves and develops, it would say prioritise certain ports. We also need the developers, once they get assigned a development area, to start engaging these local stakeholders from the outset, the very early stage, so they can see this is what we're going to need and this is what we're going to need this facility to be. Because a lot of our problems, I would say, in terms of supply chain, are the fact that we need to kind of absorb capital expenditure increases into our projects. that perhaps European neighbours don't, and we need to get certain port facilities to a certain standard that they can then compete, and as a result, a project can still have an overall competitive bid. But we do have an opportunity here with the development of floating wind, and the new sectoral plan provides a really good framework to see that take off. And as a result, it's about is exactly as you say. There's probably no one specific lead. There's probably leads from enterprise, leads from regional planning authorities, leads from local planning authorities, Marine Scotland, Crown Estate Scotland. We just need to make sure we're all very coordinated and working together on this, so that when the planning system is called upon, it can respond by having these areas identified and a lot of that comprehensive planning work in place that can enable the kind of benefits to be realised when it comes to supply chain and more kind of localised development of supply chain for future offshore wind projects.
Yeah,
thank you. And now can I come to questions from Liz Smith? Liz.
Thank you. Minister, you were very interesting in your earlier answers that you gave in the first part of the meeting to both Mark Ruskell and Finlay Carson about how you're hoping to align both national and regional policy on this. Could I ask you about the voice of local communities? Because, as I understand it, there's been quite a lot of controversy in this area. How do you think that the marine planning partnerships will provide a voice for these local communities, particularly when it comes to things like licensing decisions and obviously the consent that is required for new aquaculture sites?
I think the voice of communities within that is clearly vital, and essentially, I mean, that's what regional planning is about. We have our overarching framework there, but this is about regional decision making and the engagement of local stakeholders, obviously, of which communities are a key part of that work. So we absolutely support engagement with community groups in regional marine planning. And I think that there have been a number of initiatives that have been undertaken, which I think we can take a lot of learning from. So I spoke a bit about earlier about the money that the Clyde Marine Planning Partnership have through EMFF. So they have a project on community engagement, and Orkney are working with schools on learning about the marine environment. And there's work underway in Shetland as well, and they've really tried to engage with communities through community councils. And I think their community planning partnerships also been developing the Shetland Partnership Delivery Plan, which has really helped to try and identify community needs to feed into regional marine planning. I think, did you also talk in your question there about in relation to into licensing decisions as well?
The committee's report from the previous committee when I wasn't actually on this committee. And it strikes me that in certain areas of the country, there's been quite a lot of controversy, particularly when it comes to community engagement. And, you know, there's been some quite controversial decisions. And if you've got something like the Clyde, where you've got, you know, a lot of local authorities taking an interest, whereas, you know, somewhere like Shetland, that's not so much of a problem. And I just wondered how you foresaw a bit better engagement so that people in a local community feel that, you know, they've had their say and it's been well listened to, and that, you know, it can be fed into the decisions, particularly when, as I say, it comes to things like licensing and a new site for an aquaculture business.
Yeah, you're absolutely right there. I mean, in highlighting Clyde, because I think that given the size of the region and the size of the delegate as well, with 24 members, and I think the area that covers, so as ministers can request that we have community representatives specifically on a delegate. But again, I think from the other examples that I've talked about there, whether that's Shetland or Orkney, it isn't the only way for community interest to be represented. So I think there's flexibility within the legislation as it is right now to enable that to happen. But again, you are going to have those challenges like you have in Clyde, because say if you wanted a community representative on the delegate, it's, well, obviously they cover a wide range of communities. So it's how best each of those communities can be represented. But I mean, obviously throughout this process as well, it's not as if developing the plan is done completely in isolation or without the need to engage with communities. A community engagement is absolutely key to that in the preparation of the regional marine plans. I mean, in relation to specific licensing decisions themselves and community involvement in that, or regional marine plan and marine partnerships involvement, is that, I mean, regional marine partnerships are statutory, or would be statutory consultees to any applications. So I think they would have to look at those applications and decide whether or not, well, how they align or they don't align with any regional marine plan is in place. So I think that's where the role for them is. And obviously any individual members of that can either object or feedback through processes that are already in place to deal with that. So I think when it comes to those individual applications, I think there's mechanisms there that can be used. And obviously there is a specific role for the regional marine plan and partnership there. But I do see community engagement and involved communities as key to the success of regional marine plans as we move forward. But I think there are different mechanisms there that we can enable that to work. But again, you know, as I've said, as I can pretty much respond to in all questions that have been raised through the session today, that's where all the work and the feedback and the learning that we can take from the process so far is really important, because we need to look at, okay, well, what lessons can we learn, what has worked there, and what would need to be done if we're looking at other regions that may have similar issues or cover a similar area out to Clyde. What lessons can we take from that to ensure there is that engagement there? So again, these are all points that we'll continue to consider.
Convener, just my last point, I would suggest that, you know, there is an issue about people being able to understand how the national plan and the regional plans come together, because I think that's crucial, that there's an understanding about the overarching policy objectives. But obviously, it's helpful if we can ensure that the community voices are well heard, because that's the best way of ensuring that A, they're enthusiastic about what's happening within their own community development, but also that they feel that they've got ownership of some of these issues. So thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Liz. And just, Minister, I mean, I think that's all our questions exhausted on this, but just kind of to get some clarity, you're talking about the assessment that you're going to do, which obviously you've mentioned you'll take our feedback onto that. Did you say that would be happening in early 2021? Am I correct in saying that, or is that going to be?
In terms of the internal assessment, that's something we'd be looking to commence over the coming weeks and months. And then okay. I think we want to look at that in conjunction, well, once the committee's produced their final report, and then see what work from there we might need to do, or if any further assessment would be needed at that point. And then, of course, we would be aiming to respond to the committee's report and any recommendations that are made in full, and taking all that information into account.
Well, thank you very much, and we look forward to getting your response to our report. I want to thank you and your officials for your time this morning. That concludes our meeting in public today. At our next meeting on the 8th of December, we will consider EU exit subordinate legislation and a draft report on the committee's regional marine inquiry. Thank you all, and that concludes our public session today.